series called Bloodline. This is the story of the people who can be found in Matthew chapter 1, leading all the way up into the days and weeks before Christmas Eve. And we've talked about people who were major kings, we've talked about people who were prostitutes, we've talked about people who were in-laws and had everything, and then lost everything, and then had to cover. The variable number of people that we have in this congregation, in this place, is represented in Matthew chapter 1. It's not people that are exactly like me, or people that are exactly like you. The significance of having the series, the significance of hearing those people's stories, is knowing that we are a part of this story. It's not something that happened that we don't have to bother with, or something that happened that isn't relevant to us, or something that happened that doesn't include us. It's an amazing story that includes us all types of people. So let's look at the first piece of scripture. This is Luke chapter 1, 46 to 56. Mary said, "With all my heart I glorify the Lord. From the depths of who I am, I rejoice in God, my Savior. He has looked with favor on the low status of his servant. Look, from now on, everyone will consider me highly favored, because the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is His name." This is in the midst of a woman who was far too old to have a baby and wasn't going to have a chance to. And a woman who, right now we might consider far too young to have a baby, but at the time maybe not. Two women that are on opposite ends of the spectrum. Both being told that they are going to have a child. One being told, "Your child will set up everything to bring people back. Your child will bring people from the edges, from the borders, back to hear a message again. Your child will not participate in the things of society that distract us. Your child will be the standard in which people will follow being the underdogs." Then Mary being told, "Your child will be the Son of God Himself." I use this image frequently. I use it all year long, especially at Christmas, when we're talking about someone coming to be a human, to be present in our lives. If you have ever called a 1-800 number in order to get help with a problem, especially technical support, it can be a really, really tough thing. And it's really tough on that person, too. One of my dear people in my last church was a tech support person over the phone. And as hard as it is for you to think that you think it is to understand what that person's saying, they think it's equally hard to understand what you are saying. They may not know exactly what the problem is. They may not know. You may not have your computer on. You may not have the VCR. You may have the red and the yellow and the yellow and the red. Trying to, over the phone, channel expertise on this subject to another person and say, "What on earth is this? How can I fix it?" It's completely changed. Because God doesn't go through humans anymore, speaking to this person about to become human in Jesus. Explaining that all these complicated things to these people, clarifying in a way that would be to some comforting, to some startling, and to some confusing. So first of all, the text should say Mary sang. This is one of the beautiful songs you can find in the Bible. And she said, "He's seeking the person of low status, and that will define the Gospels." It doesn't have to always do with money. Some people are sick and are on the very edges of society because they're sick. They may be fine financially. They may be fine socially. But they're sick, and everyone fears that they will get sick if they're around them. It may be that they're poor. They may not be sick. They may not have ever participated in the high-level social parts of society. But they're poor. They don't have any sort of influence. Or they may not be sick nor poor, like the tax collector. He's in fact very rich, but completely excluded from society. Why is that? Because that person was picked by the Roman government from his own people because he knew who would be rich in the neighborhood, and he knew who he would tax the hardest. And as long as he got the Roman government, whatever amount it was, 15%, 27%, 31%, as long as he got them their money, he could collect any money over the top of that. And had the Roman army behind him. Imagine if you liked that neighbor. Probably not. So people throughout the Gospels will be sick, they'll be outcast. the the social media. So this is what Mary thinks. These people will be included. And this is something I truly noticed that she wrote. Never noticed this before. It's the first goal of life. In the depths of who I am, I rejoice in God. You notice you can use depths in two different ways. I was in the depths of what? Despair. That's one way to use it, and I think you probably used it, oh, I've used it that way this week. I was in the depths of, to get to the bottom. But you can also say from the bottom of my heart. So when you're starting to talk about digging really, really deep, you're saying, this is where I am, this is who I am, and this is what I'm going to be. It's why, if you've ever been around me, and you see me, and we've had just simple interactions even for 4 to 5 minutes, I'd rather ask you something that's not, how was the turkey at Thanksgiving? I'd rather ask you something a little more important than that. Unfortunately, if I can't ask you, if I don't know something more important than that, I won't say anything. Won't ask anything. But the conversation that drives society, 85% of conversation, how about that weather today? That, you know, that, whatever that is, isn't getting at how she feels. You say, how's it going today? Great. Fine. Looking forward to Thanksgiving. Yeah, I think we're ready. You got the Christmas presents, right? Christmas presents, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's not good. Yeah, it's who I am. So I'm curious if that is the case about ourselves. In the depths of who I am, I rejoice in God. I answered you honestly, it would depend on the day. And it doesn't, I find it doesn't have to do necessarily with whether the day has been really good or really bad. Sometimes you just don't feel it. And many of you, whatever job that you're involved in, when people look at that job and say, wow, that must be some amazing job, you might list for them two or three things that make it really hard. Two or three things that drag out the joy in that job. And so ministry is no different. And so if I'm involved in ministry every day, all week, there are times in the depths of my heart when I do not feel joy. I can feel deep sadness in the pain of another person. I can feel deep anger in the bitterness of another person. And of course, anger is only sadness poorly disguised. Sometimes you feel rejected, you feel complete pain. And you might say, in the depths of my heart, I am truly sad. Is this how 3s, 4s, and 5s? No. This is what's known as a false alarm. I have your head on a swivel, but I'm sure you might have this church and the spirit is very curious. In the depths of my heart, we're ready? Okay. That was, this is like college football. That was over there to get my eye in there. 3s, 4s, and 5s are about to sink.
We have some chairs in the back. If we have a couple of people that can help us put out more chairs, we've got plenty of chairs for people to have chairs in worship. I tell you what, if you, because of the time and because of what we're doing and because that was a better children's sermon than I'll ever do, if you would like your child to go to kids.com or Kids Connection, you can let them go now. That didn't happen today?
No.
Kids Connection and Kids.com doesn't happen today. Now, okay. Here's a rule that I've learned. When there's communion, we don't have Kids.com and Kids Connection because Reverend Temple thinks it's important for kids to have communion. Critical. I think that's important too. I didn't realize the simple rule there. We have twists when we have communion in one service and not in the other service. So we have communion in our traditional services today and no communion here. So if you are a parent going forward from this day, if we are having communion that day in the service that you're in, you do not go to kids.com. If we are not having communion in the service that you're in, you do go to kids.com. Y'all with me? Here we go. Let's look at the fill in the blank again. In the depths of who I am, I rejoice in God. If you can consistently say that, the things that happen to you in the midst of the world will not affect you like they normally would. If you have that welling up inside of you, it won't be that there, it will not be the case that you will not have immense amounts of negativity in your life. It's that those immense amounts of negativity will not prevail. And given that subject, I'm going to show you a clip from the latest version of Les Mis.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by, when hope was high and life worth living. I dreamed that love would never die. I dreamed that God would be forgiving. Then I was young and unafraid. Some dreams were made, used, wasted. There was no ransom to be paid. No song unsung, no wine untasted. But the tigers come at night, with their voices soft as thunder, as they tear your home apart, as they turn your dream to shame. Days with endless wonder. He took my childhood in his stride, but he was gone when autumn came. And still I dream he'll come to me. There are dreams that cannot be, and there are storms we cannot weather. I had a dream my life would be
much total opposite. Depths of despair versus Mary's bottom of my heart. And you are neither one nor the other. They are both inside of you.
based on experiences that you had in your childhood, based on experiences that you have
in your family, based on experiences that you have in your workplace. Both feelings, bottom of my heart and depth of despair, are inside of you. So who has broken her spirit? Humans. That's because that's what humans do. Humans are capable of needing what they need and doing what they do and wanting what they want whenever they want it. Forget the cost of you. That humans can crush you. And you can crush other humans as well. Listen to Mary describe her God again. He shows mercy to everyone from one generation to the next who honors him as God. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered those with arrogant thoughts and proud inclinations. He has pulled the powerful down from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty-handed. So she's suggesting that if major changes are going to come, they will not likely happen at the Capitol building. They will likely happen under the bridge, the street that goes by the Capitol building and out of D.C., like what we saw on the ministry video. That's where she was. She wasn't incredibly powerful. The shepherds who were told this story weren't incredibly powerful. And this a welling up of joy and compassion and love that she's describing can only be sought from God. She says kindness, compassion, favor. Not for people who are hoarding those things, but for people who will share those things. Food for the hungry. And this is your next fill in the blank. From one generation to the next. You think about these times that you have, Thanksgiving and Christmas, when you get to see the person who's been here a long time and the person who's just barely here. What is it? What are the key critical things that are being passed down from one to the other in your family? Well, that's particular to your family. But what she's saying is from one generation to the next, God is present and loving and kind and compassionate. You realize what a blink of an eye we are on this earth compared to everything that God has ever created, compared to everything that God has ever seen, compared to all the people that have ever been. This phone call is probably not the most critical thing that's ever happened on the face of the earth, though it feels like it. Or this bill, or this notice, whatever it is. Or joyful things. The thing that you must have this season is not the most critical thing that's ever been on this earth. He's saying he has been here from one generation to the next trying to explain to them what he wants them to do. I think 2 weeks ago I talked about this first instance that I'm having now coaching basketball, not being able to be on the court but having to be on the sidelines, on the bench, And telling them something and hoping that they will do it. The barriers of proper communication, of them hearing it, of them processing what we did in the 42nd minute of practice on Tuesday, and then doing it, that is a tall order. But I will keep trying to get them to do it. And when they do it, every single strain and pain and loss and whatever is all wiped away in an instant. If they just do one of those things, you just say, wow, look at that. Did you see what happened? It's the tiniest of things. Can you imagine when God watches from one generation from the next, tries to teach us, tries to inspire us, and we actually get the neighborhood of what God was actually saying, how exciting that can possibly be to God. Scripture continues. He has come to the aid of his servant Israel, remembering his mercy, just as he promised to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to Abraham's descendants forever. Mary stayed with Elizabeth about 3 months and then returned to her home. thousands of years, people have wandered off, not really paying attention. They just sort of eased away from God. For thousands of years, people have fallen through the cracks. Israel as an entire country has fallen through the cracks in the political scheme of that area. And God has not forgotten. For thousands of years, the people of Israel and Israel itself has completely turned from God willfully. I don't even like you, like the prodigal son. Just give me all my stuff and I'm leaving and I'm never looking back. And throughout those years, as people wandered away and came back, as people fell through the cracks and God found them, as people walked away in such angry fashion and then came back broken, God has been there. That's what Mary's saying. So what's the hope in that? Why share that in the Advent season? Well, the same reason I shared in the very beginning. There's hearing about it. And then they're seeing an individual. If an individual came to your home and helped you with whatever that particular thing was, I'm here to help you. And so this person, all these thoughts, all these promises, is becoming a human being coming to this earth. And this is your last fill in the blank. Remember your mercy. There was a guy who had a horrific debt, knew he couldn't pay it, went up to the judge, got on his knees, begged him and said, I'll never be able to pay this. So the judge forgave him. And you know the pain and angst that he felt walking up the stairs to see the judge. And as he was on his knees, everything that he ever felt is gone as he walks out, and he's walking out kind of proud. And who does he run into? Guy that owes him about $17. And he chokes him in judgment for owing him that money. Throws him in debtor's prison, of which you cannot recover. That's because human beings take mercy and then figure that other people aren't deserving of that mercy. We'd be far better if we said we never in a million years deserve any mercy, and we will freely give it to anyone that we see. Remember your mercy. The mercy that you have been granted. The mercy that you should offer in this season. Tension's high for you this season? Got a couple things to do? Got a couple things pressing on you? You have anything to pay for in this season? My dad used to say, he told me over Thanksgiving, in December I had to pay for both car taxes. I had to finish off my individual taxes as a real estate agent, and I had to pay for your tuition and Christmas. He said that all happened in December. Guess what concept I had of that when I was 16? I wasn't hostile to him. I really was a pretty well-behaved kid, but I had no idea he was doing all that. And so I have no idea what y'all are doing out there. But when you feel that tension and someone's pressing on you, remember the mercy that's been granted to you. Remember the mercy that you can offer others. Remember that we are celebrating the fact that God came to earth to share this amazing story, so that when we are feeling the depths of despair in our heart, He can love us to the bottom of our heart so that we can love others as well. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, help us to remember your grace. And as we sing a song of despair, help us to sing it fully, to be honest with ourselves and with our loved ones, not to push it way down or buy things or eat things to get over it. But instead, help us to sing that song of despair because you can handle it. Help us as we sing it to know that you are listening and that you care so deeply for us. Help us to feel your love in the bottom of our hearts so that it may well up inside us so that we may share it with others. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.